Thank you very much. You know, I know Bastian for 3 days. I met him 3 days ago, first time. And at the first event of us together, he spoke first and nobody listened to me after that. That's why I'm speaking first now. By the way, he's such an interesting person. I have a column in an Israeli newspaper. So yesterday I interviewed him and I wrote a column on him. And in 12 hours it got, how much? About 1,250 shares on Facebook just from Israelis. So he's a very interesting person. You will hear from him. My name is Erez. I was born in Israel. I've been living in Israel all of my life. And, I'm a board member of the place called Arava Institute. Arava Institute is a place, it's an academic place in the south of Israel that teach students, Jewish students from the US, Jewish students from Israel, Arab students from Israel, Arab students from the West Bank, and Arab students from Jordan. All of them together in the same place, where they have to learn about the studies of environment and be together and talk about the conflict and try to make solutions, because I believe in coexistence, I believe in corporations. I also launched, as the Dean mentioned, I launched the first fund in Israel that invests in socially responsible companies. I believe that investing in ethical companies generate better returns and lower level of risk. And I launched this fund about 3 years ago. And when I was looking for companies to invest for the fund, I was looking for one company named SodaStream. Are you familiar with the name?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. SodaStream is a company, it's an Israeli company that make soda vehicles for home use. And every company that I invest in, I go and speak with the company management. I visit the factory if there is, the offices, speak with people there. So I went to the SodaStream factory in the West Bank. One of the managers there is an Israeli Arab who lives in a small village, near Jerusalem. We became friends. And I saw there are 1,000 people, 1,000 workers in this factory. Half of them were Palestinians, half of them were Israelis. Among the Israelis, part of them were Arabs, part of them were Jews. And they all worked together, side by side. Israelis from Jerusalem, from Tel Aviv, from the settlements, religious, non-religious, men, women, Arabs the same, from different places, villages, cities, religious, non-religious, men, women. They all work together. And I thought to myself, this is the company that the BDS is after? This is the company that the BDS want to boycott? Doesn't make sense. So I started to investigate the Israeli industry in the West Bank. I found out that there are 50,000 Palestinians working in companies in this region. By the way, not only Israeli companies that the owners are Israelis or Jews. Some companies the owners are Palestinians and Israelis. Some companies the owners are Arabs. Only 50,000 Palestinians working there. They get paid 5 times more than their friends that working in Palestinian factories. Okay. By the way, whatever I'm telling you now, Bassam knows that he will say the same. Actually, the numbers that they're saying is a little bit higher. But I'm saying that they're getting paid 5 times more. And so they equal, in terms of income, to 250,000 Palestinians, working Palestinians. It's very important because they get paid 3.6 billion shekels a year, which is almost $1 billion a year. And that's a huge amount for the Palestinian economy. Now, this money goes strictly to private consumption, to buy food, to buy clothes, to buy shoes, for this stuff. And you know, the Palestinian economy, when we talk about the Palestinian economy, we're talking about 23% unemployment in the West Bank, 45% unemployment in the Gaza Strip. Okay? The Gaza Strip, by the way, you know, there was an industrial area right to the border of the Gaza Strip on the land of Israel. 4,000 Palestinians were walking there. The Hamas shot at that industrial area every day, bullets, missiles every day, until all the factories moved from there. Now it's empty. There is no one there. 4,000 Palestinians lost their jobs. That means 40,000 Palestinians approximately lost their source of food. Another unknown of Palestinians, another communities and circles of Palestinians that are working to provide those workers the goods and the services that they need, also got damaged economically. That was happening in the Gaza Strip, but let's go back to the West Bank. I'll give you two examples. By the way, before the examples, if the BDS succeed, for example, and the Israeli factories will move out of the West Bank, the 50,000 Palestinians will lose their jobs. So we're not talking about 50,000 Palestinians who support their families. We're talking about other circles that provide them the goods and services. We're talking about hunger. We're talking about anarchy. We're talking about chaos in the region. That all leads to one thing, war. But if we will get more factories getting into the West Bank, another 50,000 Palestinians working for these factories, then we're talking about people making a living, we're talking about peace between people. I'll give you two examples. When SodaStream left the West Bank, you know, in the last year, SodaStream left the West Bank, moved to the Negev. The Negev is an area in the south of Israel, near a city called Rahat. Rahat is a city of Bedouins, city that suffers from a very high rate of unemployment. So SodaStream chose to build the factory on a private land, by the way, private Israeli land, near Rahat, and they hire hundreds of Bedouins. Now, I was invited about a month ago to a party. They call it a peace party, SodaStream. That was a party for the new factory. They invited all of the Bedouins from Rahat, Israelis from the area, and Palestinians that worked for SodaStream. I've been there. You know what was the most exciting thing in this party? One lady called Shulamit Gonen. That's her name. She got stabbed 2 months ago, before the party, about 2 months before the party. She got stabbed in the market of Rahat when she went to buy vegetables and stuff for the weekend. And she came to this party, to this peace party with all the Bedouins, with all her neighbors, to make peace, the lady that got stabbed before. So that's what SodaStream does. So they hired hundreds of Bedouins, helped to reduce the unemployment rate. And I would think that the BDS, the guys that want to boycott companies that working in the West Bank, I would think that they will say to SodaStream at this point, thank you very much. Thank you for getting out of the West Bank. Thank you for hiring hundreds of Bedouins. Thank you for doing a peace party for everybody. Thank you. No, the BDS is still after the company. They still want to boycott the company's products. I don't understand it. I don't understand it unless the BDS doesn't want the Israelis out of the West Bank, but the BDS wants the Israelis out of Israel. Otherwise, I don't understand it, because the factory now is not within the borders of 67, it's even within the borders of 48. Now, another short example of a company called Bagel Bagel, a company that makes pretzels. This company was bought by Unilever. You know Unilever, right? Global food company. Unilever bought Bagel Bagel, and they forced the management of the company to close the factory in the West Bank and to open a new one instead in the north of Israel. Now what happened? 150 workers of Bagel Bagel, Palestinian workers of Bagel Bagel, got fired. Bagel Bagel moved. Immediately, a few days after that, another factory, another company got into the same place that Bagel Bagel was. The industrial area didn't lose money for even one day. Bagel Bagel didn't lose money, they moved to the north of Israel. 150 Israelis in the north of the country were happy, they found a new job. 150 Palestinians are still, 3 years after, looking for a job. I know that they are still looking for a job because I spoke 3 weeks ago with a manager of a food factory that's located in the same industrial area. He told me that he still gets phone calls from Bagel Bagel's Palestinian employees that they are looking desperately for a job. And you know what? It's not only about the money. Really, it's not the money. You know, in the last half year, I think that there wasn't even one single day without Jews getting stabbed or shot. Whether it's in Tel Aviv, or in the West Bank, or in Jerusalem, or in other cities. Or one single day without Palestinians trying to stab or to shot Israelis. In these factories, for the last 10, 15 years, nobody got hurt. Nobody. Not even one. And in the last few months, I've been visiting a lot of these factories. I'm getting in there. Hundreds of Palestinians and Israelis walking together, holding blades, drills, knives, if we're talking about food factories, holding knives, cutting vegetables, holding sharp metals in the industry. Nobody gets hurt. Nobody. And you know, it's normal what I'm saying. I mean, it should be normal. It's normal in other areas of the world. But in Israel, when people get stabbed every day because of the conflict, it's not normal. It's quite magical even. And it happens because in these factories, I won't say 100% of them, but in most of these factories, in those I've seen, people, Palestinians and Israelis, get equal rights, equal benefits, equal salary, equal opportunities even. I can tell you about people and Israeli Arabs that opened factories in the West Bank hiring Arabs and Jews. I can tell you about Palestinian managers of divisions, managing Israelis and Palestinians under them. I can tell you about beautiful stories that are happening there. And when people see that they get the same respect, they pay back respect. They put the conflict aside, they come to work, they want to make a living, they want to give food for their kids. And yes, they want to get respect also, and they get respect there, so they pay respect. I'm saying that once we have a future agreement between the Palestinians and the Israelis, I heard Bastian yesterday saying that he doesn't believe in it. He will say it himself. Whether you believe it or not, if we will have a future agreement, the agreement won't last, a paper won't last. Signing on a paper is not enough. A future agreement will have to have the support, the backup of the people. And the support and the backup of the people is being built in these factories. These factories are the places where people, Palestinians and Israelis, break down walls of hatred and fear, walk together, side by side, shoulder to shoulder, and build up friendship and respect to each other. So when we have a future agreement, it will be backed by the people who walk together, as long as we don't have an agreement, working together, people making a living, people don't want to lose what they have. That reduces violence. That makes peace between people. Before talking about peace between nations, between countries, we need to talk about peace between people. And that's why we build this peace between people in these factories. So I'm launching a fund that will invest in these factories, in these companies. And I'll be honest with you, when I go to the supermarket, I prefer to buy products that have been manufactured in the West Bank. Because I know that when I buy this product, I contribute to coexistence, to normalization, and to a future peace. Not a future peace, even to peace now, to peace between people. When you support the boycott of these companies, you break all of those beautiful things. So that's my view, that's my opinion. I'm calling everybody that I meet with. No matter what is your political views, you know, factories can move from one place to another. That's work. Factories are moving from the US to China, to India, back to the US. Until we have an agreement, we need to take advantage of the economy to make peace between people. That's what we do with these factories, with these industrial areas in the West Bank. I'll be happy after Bassam will speak, I'll be happy to answer any of your questions. Thank you very much.